Jen, is it okay if we start?
Yeah.
All right. Welcome, everyone. Dr. Lazama is out of town, so I am stepping in. I guess I haven't done terribly in my substitute duty, so I got called again. But it is my absolute pleasure to introduce to everyone Dr. Shiroky, who is obviously one of our faculty members. Hopefully you know her already. In case you didn't know, she studied undergrad at Vassar, got her BA in psychology. And I'm assuming this was a junior year abroad that you went to Australia?
And then I took a gap year. I was going to move there permanently. And then my family said they would never do that flight again. And here I am, back in Florida. The perfect child who stayed local.
We apologize. spent a year in Melbourne. Did not pick up an accent, returned, went to Miami. I don't know if that's your hometown, but returned to Miami, did a combination MD MPH degree, and then moved north to Hopkins for her internship and residency before coming to Tampa 2021, joined the faculty, and is currently our interim GIM division director. I will tell you, I like your CV quite a bit simply because of the adventure that's in there. And I think it's hopefully folks that are listening can understand that, Tampa is great, USF is great, but there's something to be gained and learned from travels, from experiencing different perspectives, different cultures, different climates, different accents. So I applaud the travels up and down the East Coast and then across the Pacific. So that's wonderful. And I didn't know that about you in the Australia things, looking over your CV. Without further ado, I present Dr. Shiroky for Grand Rounds.
All right. Thanks, everyone, for joining in. Happy to be here and excited to be presenting you about this, maybe not like the most talked about subject in care, but I think actually is present in every patient experience that we have. To start, just taking off a tradition of one of my mentors, I wanted to start with a book recommendation that doesn't have to do actually with the talk. So for those of you who are readers or audiobook listeners out there, I prefer nonfiction, but every now and then I do throw in a book that might actually help with my professional life. With my professional life. And this was a book that was introduced to me in residency that I really enjoyed and found helpful. It's Rest by Alex Sejong Kim Peng. And what it is, it's a reflection, but also a deep dive into the evidence behind the importance of taking time to rest and recognizing that if taking time to rest helps us all perform better. And I can hear all the residents giggling with their microphones off. But having time to rest does help you perform better across all of your sort of roles and dimensions of life. And what the author is arguing is that we should all treat rest with the same intention as we do the rest of our to-do list. So it shouldn't be a passive activity like binging TV or scrolling on Instagram or scrolling endlessly online and jumping around for hours to try and rest, but you should actually plan your rest periods for things that are restful for you. So things that you find recharging within the time that you have available. So ideally, we all like to rest on weekends. Sometimes we end up taking a position, like I made the bright idea of a couple months ago, that require us to work on weekend days from time to time, every weekend day. But I have now begun to frame it to, okay, in the time that I have available, what can I do that's restorative and restful? And the other take home quote I really liked about it was rest shouldn't be a reward for only when you've gotten everything done. It should be part of your to-do list. All right, so I want to talk about advanced care planning, and upon reflection and my research for this talk, I sort of came up more with the idea of advanced care philosophizing. So why is this important to me? I think kind of like how we talk about a hidden curriculum in medical education, I think the longer I practice, there's a hidden practice to clinical practice. And I think advanced care planning, and that being the term that's most familiar with people, but really discussing with patients what their understanding of their healthcare is, what their goals are, what their values are, what are we planning for, is woven with every patient experience I've had, from being a medical student to being a resident to now being in general practice now as an attending. I've seen many patients defy the odds, and if they had asked me what their prognosis was, I would have said, I suspect you have another year or two to live, and they've lived longer. And then I've had lots of patients who've defined the odds, who, you know, are being hospitalized for end stage cardiac disease, pulmonary disease, expected to die within the year, and then they do. And I've helped a lot of patients and their family members, you know, grieve loss. And there's a big difference between grieving loss of a death that occurred with dignity and with some at least understanding on the survivor's behalf versus processing and reframing grief of a traumatic and chaotic death. And I think this became most evident to me as a resident. In medical school, I don't think I got much exposure, if at all, to advanced care planning or having these discussions with patients. We did have a geriatrics rotation, but it was largely well patients, well older adults in Palm Beach. And then at the start of residency, and I learned a lot of how to have these conversations in residency, but on my initial intro, the training was, you know, when you admit a patient, you have to ask their code status. And when you go into code status, you just don't want to say, do you want us to try and restart your heart? If it stops, our training was go into as much detail as possible. I think largely that what it was influenced by was the patient population coming into the hospital having a very low likelihood of a successful resuscitation, and if they were resuscitated, having a meaningful recovery. But we were taught, like, okay, we're going to discuss code status. When you ask a patient code status, you say, do you want us, if your heart stops, do you want us to pound on your chest? Do you want us to put a tube down your throat and put you on a machine that'll make you breathe? And that didn't seem like maybe the correct way either. I've spent a lot of time thinking about this topic, and I'm hoping I'll be able to provide some points that you find helpful as you move forward in your practices. So disclosures, I'm not a master or expert clinician in these areas. The contents of these slides are based on CMS guidelines, expert opinion, peer-reviewed articles, positions written by major medical organizations and governing bodies, and then they're infused with some of my personal experiences along the way. This is introductory information and by no means all-inclusive review of advanced care planning. The techniques and resources that I'll be introducing during this presentation are not absolute and aren't appropriate for all clinical situations, but they're just good things to have in your toolbox as you're presented with different patient experiences. And this presentation presents advanced care planning practice recommendations to strive towards, but are often not the reality of everyday practice, but are achievable with intention and direction. So you shouldn't end this presentation being like, wow, Dr. Shiroky is like a wizard at advanced care planning and all her patients are beautifully tied up in a bow. And if you ask them if they understand what their health is and what their current status is and what they should expect, they'll be able to report back to you. These are things that I strive for. These are things that come to mind throughout my practice, but I'm certainly not perfect at it either. So objectives for this, we're going to be reviewing the traditional approach to advanced care planning. Reframe advanced care planning as a dynamic longitudinal process, discuss shifting the focus of advanced care planning from predicting in advance to preparing for in-the-moment decisions, and provide resources that providers and patients can use both in the inpatient and outpatient settings. Common phrases that you'll hear when talking about advanced care planning. So advanced directives, that's an umbrella term for patients' treatment preferences if they end up in a situation where they're no longer able to make decisions for themselves. Living wills describe the treatment an individual would like to receive if they lose decision-making capacity. And a durable power of attorney for healthcare is an appointed surrogate who would make these treatment decisions. The POLST and the MOLST, so these are similar documents. It just depends on what state you what state you practiced in. So I practice with the Molst in Maryland, and we have the Pulst in Florida. But these are the orders that patients may place in advance for their preferences for life-sustaining treatment. And I'll show you guys some examples of this. So the traditional concept of advanced care planning is largely policy driven. So there wasn't much said about it in the mid 1900s. And then as we turn the corner into the 1980s, 1990s, there started to be more attention placed on how patients were being treated at end of life in largely the hospital setting, and was it in line with what they had expressed for, what they had wanted. So the government made policies for us to try and improve this. So CMS brought up a requirement. So they defined an advanced directive as written instruction, such as a living will or durable power of attorney for healthcare recognized under state law relating to the provision of healthcare when the individual is incapacitated. And they mandated, some of you may be surprised to see this, but it does happen, you know, in all hospitals across the country. It's more of paperwork that the patient gets and less a conversation, but hospitals, critical access hospitals, skilled nursing facilities, home health agencies, hospices, and religious non-medical healthcare institutions are required to provide patients upon admission or initiating care. So I think home health agencies have to do it even before they actually assess the patient. Information on what an advanced directive is, and to ask them, and to have the abilities within their medical records to record it. So you'll see when we're on Epic, when you're up on the left-hand corner, you look under the bubble of the patient's picture, it'll say, you know, I think it says ACP, not on file, or if there is one there, it's there. But they're not required to have the individual fill it out. So they just have to let them know that it exists. The deliverables for this are identifying a surrogate medical decision maker, clarifying wishes for specific interventions as appropriate, and usually the most common ones are things like dialysis, mechanical ventilation, CPR, and then complete at the end of this visit the orders for pertaining to life-sustaining treatment. So I have some links. It's going to be a little dizzying, so I apologize. We couldn't figure out how to embed them. But I do have, so each state has their own advanced directive. All the states are stored on this website, which I think it was called caringinfo.org. So hopefully you've all been exposed to this. If you're practicing in Florida, this is the Florida Advanced Directive. I'm not going to go through all of it in detail. It is worded for patients. It's not a healthcare provider document, or at least worded in that way. It's supposed to be accessible to the general population, and it has some of the, like, I guess, the things you would assume would be an advanced directive. So, who would be your health surrogate? Instructions for healthcare. So, what the health surrogate can weigh in on. One I found really interesting is that they can decide to make an anatomical gift. So that's donation of organs or a body for research or for other uses. And you sign it. And then there's a living will that can also be filled out. So this is willfully voluntarily make known my desire that my dying not be artificially prolonged under the circumstances set forth. I have a terminal condition, I have an end stage condition, or I'm in a persistent vegetative state. And we're not going to fall down that rabbit hole, but I'm sure anyone who's practiced medicine that a lot of these can be quite challenging to define. There is no set definition in medicine on how to say someone is in any of these categories. And then there's the option for organ donation. The other advanced directive that Florida has, which I actually discovered looking for this, preparing for this talk, and I think is fairly interesting, is there's a mental health advanced directive that is valid in the state of Florida. And most states do have a mental health advanced directive. I've never used this with a patient, again, because I didn't know it existed. But I would, thinking back at some of the patients I've cared for. And what this is a specific instructions for surrogates in the setting that someone loses their capacity and decision-making abilities due to a mental health illness. So individuals who you may have with decompensated bipolar or decompensated schizophrenia who are found to no longer have capacity, sometimes it would probably be great to have a document like this. So something to broach with your patients before they get to that point of decompensation. And it actually is quite thoughtful. And I think in some ways kind of probably previously trauma-based focus. So the patient can at least put in some preferences of the facility they'd want to be treated at, their preference for the physician who might be consulted and physicians that they don't want to be treated by, information of so who finds out about involuntary admissions, what they consent to as far as medications. They even have a space that says, you know, if they if an emergency intervention is needed to restrain the patient, what would their preference be? Again, these aren't legally binding to honor, but they are very helpful to guide care. You know, if the options are there, they can say this would be their preferences. And then who would give consent? And you can even say, you know, I allow my surrogate to consent for me to participate in experimental studies versus not. So a cool document there that was new to me. It may not be new to you, but I hadn't seen it before. And since I'm already in this screen, this is what's on the next slide. This is the POLST. So the difference between the advance directive and the POLST, the advance directive just needs to be signed by two witnesses, and one of them can't be a blood relative. The POLST has to be signed by a physician. So this is something you would do with the patient, or the patient would bring in and you would fill out during your visit. So the POLST has the options. So you can clarify if you would want CPR done, if you're unresponsive, pulseless, or not breathing. If you have a pulse or breathing, your preference for either full treatment, limited medical intervention, and I think this does a good way of sort of capturing where things can get quite sticky for surrogates. So antibiotics, do they want fluids? Do they want cardiac monitoring? What level of airway interventions would they want? And then comfort measures. And this is one of my favorite ways to frame dying for patients. And when you're counseling on that, and I think we don't say it enough, is allowing for a natural death. So you're not hastening death, but you are allowing for it to occur. Patient can put down their preferences if they would want long-term nutrition, some information if they are enrolled in palliative care or not. And so again, this is signed by a physician and they have to have a license within the state. I'm going to go back to my PowerPoint. Sorry, I'm on two screens, so I'm going to disappear just for a second so I can pull up my notes. Okay, so we went over the POLST. I'm going to go to the next slide. This was just in case my link didn't work. And then hopefully, again, this is going over the sort of traditional sense of advanced care planning. Hopefully, many of us are familiar with the Do Not Resuscitate order. So this is Form 1896 in Florida. And what a patient can specify in here, or an individual can specify, is that they do not wish for emergency personnel to provide them with resuscitation. So emergency personnel, EMS, and to my understanding, emergency medicine providers are required to provide CPR unless there's a separate directive to not to. The Do Not Resuscitate order, important things, if patients are accessing this on their own, it has to be signed by a physician for EMS to honor it, and it has to be printed on yellow paper. And the advice is usually to place it on the refrigerator, and that's where EMS looks for it. So if it's not signed by a physician or it's not on yellow paper, then it will not necessarily be honored if EMS is called to the patient's home. We are all expected to be involved in advanced care planning. So this is from the latest edition of the American College of Physicians Ethics Manual. They state that physicians should routinely raise advanced planning with adult patients and with decision-making capacity and encourage them to review their values and preferences with their surrogates and family members. So again, you don't have to review it all within the visit, but you should encourage them to have these discussions. And then the second portion stated in the manual refers to that act I referenced before, the Patient Self-Determination Act in 1990, that made it so that certain healthcare institutions are required to ask patients if they have an advance directive, provide them with information, but it does not require them to complete them. So why don't we see more advanced directives? A lot of reasons, and many of these, if you've been practicing, are probably familiar with. So there's issues with validity and reliability. So we are asking individuals to make decisions with and make informed decisions and choices without information or actually, you know, knowing if something is going to occur and if it is, in what setting and what their life landscape will look like at that time. And there's variability in how the questions are posed. An example of that is, you know, what's your code status? Do you want us to resuscitate or you are not? Or what's your code status? Do you want us to pound on your chest and place a tube down your throat and help you breathe and then place you in the ICU sedated on pressors? There's issues with durability. So people's medical preferences change over time. Their health changes over time. So it's not, advanced care is not, it's not static. Efficacy. So they're often not sufficiently clear to guide management. So it may be helpful in the sense of, you know, does this patient want dialysis? Does they not? But, you know, do they want antibiotics? And if they want antibiotics, do they want oral antibiotics? Do they want IV antibiotics? Thinking, you know, are they going to go home? Are they going to stay here at the hospital? Accessibility. So where are these documents located? If they're in the bedside table of at the patient's home and nobody knows about it or nobody has a copy of it, it's not helpful. If they're in the chart of the primary care provider who's not in the healthcare system that the patient's hospitalized in, that's problematic. And then there's issues with portability. So that's, things differ from state to state. So if you're moving around, we have a lot of patients who spend half their time on the west coast of Florida and half their time either in the Midwest or in New England or New York. There's different, the laws vary from state to state. So this is, if you take anything away from this lecture, it's the term, the bull looks different in the ring. So this was one of my favorite and probably most profound talks I attended when I was a resident. It was done by Dr. Thomas Finucane, who is a geriatrician up at Hopkins. For those who move in the geriatrician world, it'll be a familiar name. And he was discussing and he was counseling us as residents on how to approach people's code status choices from a non-judgmental place. So as a geriatrician, there are often patients who, if we were given the choice, given their health status, their age, their comorbidities, we would not choose for ourselves to be resuscitated, but they still do. And that is, as a provider, I've been there, and I'm sure many of you, if anyone's gone through internal medicine training, you've had patients like this where you are committed by profession to honor the patient's wishes of resuscitating, even if it's something that you would not want for yourself or a loved one. So with advanced care planning in its traditional form, we're asking patients to make decisions far in advance and imagine choices they'd make during a health crisis, sometimes before a diagnosis even exists. And it's truly impossible for someone to know for certain how they're going to feel or what's going to be important to them in that moment until they're there. Practicing medicine, making medical decisions as a team and as a family and with loved ones, it requires flexibility and pivots. These are complex decisions. There's a lot of uncertainty. They are laden with emotion in these types of settings, and things can change very rapidly. So the static form of advanced care planning and advanced directive doesn't allow for this. So the paradigm shift that's been very slowly occurring in advanced care planning is moving towards what if. So what if this happens to what is happening right now? So I've mentioned before, healthcare decisions are made over many individual moments in response to information at hand. And we should all be focusing more on goal-oriented planning. So the goals that are identified in these advanced care planning conversations, through an ongoing conversation between patients, loved ones, surrogates, decision makers, providers, responding to the current state of health and prioritizing for the reasonably near future, not necessarily a what if situation. So when can these discussions occur? These are some examples, some suggestions. So for those of you who see patients on a regular basis, having it part of your annual visit practice. So the annual Medicare wellness visit does include this question. It is not required for advanced care planning counseling, but it is encouraged during these visits. In general, you know, all private insurance companies also cover an annual visit with the primary care. It's not a requirement of the visit, but it's something that you can just squeak into your template on Epic so you don't forget to ask the question. The other time I regularly assess, at least this in some capacity, is when patient has an upcoming procedure. And this was a practice I developed as a resident because I'd had enough patients who had come in and needed to be proceduralized and nobody had any idea what their wishes were and who would be making decisions for them if they either they came to the hospital unable to make decisions or they would lose it after the surgery and who was going to be there. And we'd frequently have to refer back to state law, which may not align with the actual patient, family, and friend dynamics. So before an upcoming procedure, I have in my preoperative assessment template, what's the patient's code status so the surgeon knows, making sure they understand if they are, do not resuscitate, that this is likely going to be reversed while they're in surgery and then returned after the operation. And then who would make decisions for them? And I always document that in the note for the surgeon. Other times that can be opportunities to talk about, you know, patients' goals, values, the understanding of their health is post-hospitalization. So after a critical illness or a change in their perception of their health, if someone is diagnosed with a difficult to predict disease, a patient mentions that a friend or family member has recently died is an opportunity to see where that patient is at in reflecting on what their wishes would be. A new diagnosis or a change in prognosis, the diagnosis of a new life-limiting disease, and at the very bare minimum, a patient who you suspect will die within the year. Here's an example from the Thoracic Society Clinical Policy Statement on Palliative Care. And I think it does a nice example of what a lot of individuals who are diagnosed with chronic conditions that are progressive and eventually advanced to be life-limiting, what their health history looks like. So you can see initially, so the non-broken line, so the full line, is the curative restorative care process. So the focusing on either treatment for a cure or maintaining life as for as long as possible. And the asterisks sort of represent acute events where care has been accelerated. So that could be a hospitalization. And what they recommend in the background, which again is a wonderful practice, very hard to implement. I've yet to identify outpatient palliative services in Tampa, aside from when someone has already advanced to hospice care. I have not had success there. So again, this is an ideal practice, but having palliative care in the background and then, you know, having conversations at each of these peaks. And then as care is decreased in its intensity and patients transition to hospice. So there's a timeline of spaces where you could have conversations again and again. I think when we think about advanced care planning, at least for me and in a lot of educational spaces, the first things we think about are patients with cancer, either a new diagnosis or advanced stage cancer. We had taking care of them in the outpatient setting, taking care of them in the inpatient setting. Probably not the only one to ponder how has this person gotten to this point and does not have some at least direction of where they want their care taken if they should become critically ill or unable to make decisions. But, you know, their cancer, the other leading causes of death in the United States, cardiovascular disease being the most common, and then pulmonary disease. And there actually is a decent amount of literature within critical care and pulmonology on reflecting on how do we identify these patients and who should be prioritized. So I remember as resident, we got a talk on admissions, admitting patients with COPD. And the presenter brought up this graph of mortality once someone is at the point where they require more than one hospitalization for an exacerbation within a year. And I just, that's like what burned into my mind. You know, at some point in time, patients need to at least be offered the opportunity to understand what the possible timeline for their care might look like. So this is from CHEST. And these are the recommendations put forward for critical care. And I thought actually, you know, when I went through them, they all made sense as to what you think of life-limiting pulmonary disease. So obviously, if a patient requests a conversation, you should have it. If they believe the patient may die in the next year, one or more hospitalizations in the prior year for pulmonary disease, a history of an ICU admission with respiratory failure, requirement of home oxygen therapy, FEV1, so severely decreased at less than 30, a Bode index of greater than or equal to 5, unintentional weight loss, decreased functional capacity, refractory breathlessness, cor pulmonale, ILD, needing for vasodilators, undergoing lung volume reduction surgery, or undergoing evaluation for transplantation or primary lung malignancy. And, you know, it's, at least for me, looking through this list, it all made sense. These were the conditions I have been taught to see as severe pulmonary disease, but I thought there was something very helpful for providers to just have a list to refer to. And thinking about, you know, unfortunately, we all don't have the time to have conversations like this with all our patients on a regular basis, but these would be the ones to prioritize. So what do we bring to these conversations or these discussions? So the goal of advanced care planning, or, you know, advanced care planning re-envisioned as in the moment planning or near future, not so advanced care. So the goal is to set up the patient's team and caregivers to try to make the best possible in the moment decisions. So it's a space for patients to articulate values in a way that they can guide future directions and discuss important goals. So from the provider standpoint, what the patient often expects is obviously to present with a diagnosis if you're able to, present with a prognosis and treatment options. In primary care, I feel comfortable with the diagnosis. Where I often run into trouble is the prognosis part of it. Specialties are just evolving at such a rapid pace in what their management options are. It can be, you know, quite difficult to really know what is available to the patient, what the prognosis is. So this is something I'm going to put a plug out for all my specialists on the line. If it isn't part of your routine practice, within the realm that you feel comfortable and able, and there is evidence for it, it's helpful to discuss the prognosis of these patients. The patients bring a lot more of this conversation. So this should really be a conversation where you look back and you're like, okay, I max talked 10% of the time and the patient talked 90% of the time, and then we did an okay job. So the patient, it should be a space for them to talk about their values and goals. So what are the goals of their care? Are they trying to reach an important milestone like a graduation or a wedding? Is the goal symptom management? Do they want to be spending time with particular individuals, and how can we support that? What their hopes are. So asking them, you know, what outcomes do you hope for? If you were in this situation, what would you hope for? And on the flip side of that, their fears. So if you were in this situation when posing, you know, planning, what would you be worried about? Patient preferences, their expectations of the team and their care, and making sure that aligns with what we see in clinical practice. I like this one. So taking some time to really understand what living well looks like to that patient, because that's very subjective. The place that correlates best for me in practice is like when I see patients who are on chronic opiate therapy for pain management, the understanding that living well for someone who is on chronic therapy looks different based on, you know, what they're taking and what their pain is from. So getting an idea from patients like what a meaningful life of living well would look like. And this is one that I'm going to try and do better. I hadn't thought about it until I was preparing for this talk, but also providing some leeway for surrogates. So if in this conversation, if a patient's request is that under any circumstances that they be given the opportunity to die at home, you know, what if it's too hard for your loved ones to take care of you at home and for you to die at home? What would you want? Or if they want whatever their physician recommends done, or they want all treatment, you know, what would you want if your physician recommends against any further treatment? And starting to pose those questions so that surrogates have some space to make decisions that may not be as black and white as what's been written down. Who benefits from advanced care planning? Everybody does. The patients, the surrogates, the care team, the surviving loved ones. And do we do this? No, we don't. So the policies were, again, placed to try and increase the number of adults who have a written advance directive. And at least at the last, most recent study I could find, 2/3 of adults in the U.S. still do not have an advance directive. When asked, the majority of patients, and this is these studies are largely looking at patients with cancer, advanced cardiovascular disease, and advanced pulmonary disease. The majority of patients will say they've never discussed end of life decisions with their physicians, but they are open to it. They want to have more honest conversations related to end of life, including in that early prognostic period. And this was a really disturbing study. There's a few of these actually that when looked at, often patients' preferences are discordant in what we from what we have documented in a hospital chart. So there was a really important article that was in JAMA a while ago now. It was 2013. I'm just going to read part of their results. So they looked at 12 acute care hospitals across the country of Canada, involved a little under 278 patients and 225 family members in these discussions. And they found that less than 1/3 of patients and families reported they had been asked about their advanced care plans on admission to the hospital. Of patients who reported a preference for use of life-sustaining treatments, nearly 30% did not have any documentation of this preference in the medical record. When preferences were documented, in more than 2/3 of these cases, the documented preferences were discordant from the patient or family's expressed preferences. So I'm just going to let that sit with everybody, but certainly some very worrisome numbers there. So what are our barriers to having these conversations? Because we know they're good, and they're helpful, and there is evidence that it does improve end of life. It reduces cost due to reducing more intensive therapies that may not be effective. So on the healthcare provider side, time is a big one. Comfort and confidence is huge, and so is competency. So the first time I encountered competency in advanced care planning, and this is not shed a good light on patient care for this example, but I'm going to be honest with you. So when I was a medical student at the VA, we admitted a patient for dyspnea. And what we found in the workup was that they had a malignant effusion causing a trapped lung from recurrent prostate cancer. So we drained the effusion, we put in the catheter, we had the discussions, you know, the lung was completely fibrotic, so he was gonna need a full catheter. And then the team proceeded to counsel the patient to palliative care, to hospice, and goals of care. And I think we're still in the generation where people will remember scrubs. So if you do remember scrubs and you remember the episode where the dermatologist gets called in for the first time and they come like throwing everybody out of the hallway because it's the first time they've ever been called in on a weekend for a consult, which we know is not true for the dermatologist who may be on, but it is a comical episode. That's pretty much how the oncologist came into the patient's room at that time. So we were not. And I was the med student, so if I could take full responsibility. But the team was not competent to be having that conversation with the patient. They were not aware of, you know, what was the prognosis of this level of metastatic prostate cancer and what were the opportunities available for treatment. And the oncologist was able to frame it as such that the patient could likely live a meaningful life, albeit with a pulmonary, with a pleural cath, for 5 to 10 years on the current treatment. And it was an incredibly humbling experience. And thankfully, the patient was actually, patients put a lot of trust in us. And I think they often don't pick up when maybe there's been a misstep or we've made a mistake. But it was my first lesson. I was a third year medical student, and the importance of competency in having these conversations. And I carry that a lot with me in primary care. Because I find myself in a similar situation. I feel very comfortable with the relationships that I get to form to explore patients' goals, values, hopes, fears, general understanding of their health. But when they're diagnosed with a critical illness or potentially life-limiting illness, I'm not in the position to prognosticate them. So I can provide anecdotes, I can share expert opinions, look over guidelines, do some of my own research, but I do rely on specialty practices to help guide the patient through that aspect. Comfort and confidence is also really important as a provider. So medicine is a heterogeneous profession, and it's definitely a team sport. There are a lot of personalities that contribute to, and skills and interests that contribute to a patient's health journey. So like all things in medicine, you should not embark on these conversations. You should not embark on patient management practices that you feel are outside your scope or you're ill-equipped to guide the patient through. You're not required to have these conversations, but what you do need to do is try to identify and refer patients to someone who they can consult on these issues if they need to. And that's the same in any practice, anything in medicine. Similar to patient capacity. It's very well documented that the best situation is to have the primary providers to assess and determine a patient's capacity when it's in question. But when the team feels unable to do so accurately or fairly, they should not do it and they should refer to psychiatry. Similarly, in the ICU rotations, I think that I'm not in the ICU anymore. I haven't been in the ICU in years, but I did enjoy it when I was a resident for a finite period of time. When I think back on my residency ICU rotations, there are clearly team members who are frankly more comfortable and better equipped to have the end of life conversations, and we called upon them. And I was one of them who you may be able to assume I was one of them who was more comfortable. So when it was appropriate, it wasn't, you know, we didn't ask a provider who didn't feel like they could have the conversation in a appropriate or meaningful way with the patient or the caregivers. You want someone who feels confident and comfortable in doing so. From a patient standpoint, the barriers, so fear, resistance, feeling it's irrelevant or not applicable. So it's can be quite challenging to talk to a healthy person on how they would perceive what they would wish if their health should like sort of precipitously decline, or even patients who are not yet comfortable with or are still processing a poor diagnosis. They may not find it applicable. And then bad experiences. So I see this a lot with older adults. They've seen other friends, family members, loved ones go through palliative and hospice care and have perceived a certain thing occurring. So for example, a patient who has metastatic cancer that doesn't have, there's no treatment options left that I've seen, continues to resist a referral to hospice because their perception was when their neighbors were on hospice, they were just left in bed all day in their urine and stool and just given medications to pretty much snow them. And that was their perception. I can't say as to what was happening in the neighbor's house and what the care was, but that comes up a lot. Other barriers that are just sort of general, so changes in preferences, variability of disease, so we can't predict the future, we don't have a crystal ball, and then cultural adaptation. And since there's not a lot of focus or money put into end of life care, there has been a lot of money put into trying to get people to fill out advanced directives, but not so much on the rest of the research. Cultural adaptation isn't quite there. So how can we have these conversations? There are a lot of mnemonics out there. You probably learned some when you're in medical school about how to have end of life care conversation or goals of care discussions. This is one of my favorites. It is called the three-act model for goals of care discussions. And it always reminds me of like when you're taught to write essays in grade school, because you got that, like, you start out broad and then you have your thesis, then you get narrow, and then you come out and bring out to the big picture again. This is how I often address these types of conversations, and it doesn't have to necessarily. So this was designed for goals of care conversations in the ICU, but it is not necessarily, it's not necessarily confined to that. So this works, at least for me, perfectly well in the outpatient setting. So the idea, it's like a story or a play. So you have your prologue to the play where you set the stage. You talk to consultants, you talk to other providers, you identify what the issues, the questions are, invite the people who should be there, and let everybody know we're here today to talk about the big picture of this person's health. Act one, listen to the patient. What do they want to know? Some patients don't want to know the details at all as to what's going on with their health, and that's okay. Who can we talk to about it is usually a good next step. But what do you want to know as a person? What do you understand from your health situation? What are you hoping for? Cycling back into that. Act two, which is the small, small part. Remember I said about 10% of the conversation should be you talking, 90% should be the patient. So this is when you ask to share your medical point of view. And some patients will say no, and then your percentage is even smaller. But this would be, once you've assessed what the patient knows, what they understand, what they want to know, then you can step in and share what you feel as a medical team. So the medical point of view, best case scenarios, likely scenarios, worst case scenarios, and then you come back out broad. About facilitating decisions together on how you're going to move forward. So these are the options. What are we thinking? And then, like any good story, there's an epilogue. What were the takeaways of this discussion as a team? If it's a team-based, so like in the ICU, you would do a debrief and loop in other relevant providers. So that's a nice way that I like to approach it. It's easy for me to remember. Talk to the patient, have the patient talk. I share my view, my advice or my guidance. And then the patient decides, or the caregivers, or the surrogates. Here are some practice hacks. We don't all have time, or I don't think any of us really regularly have time to have these long conversations, and we have to make time. So one of the things to do, including patient goals and value in the note templates. So when I was a resident on my admitting HMP, and this was the practice of one of our teaching teams, was the template for the team had in it patients' goals for the hospitalization or patients' values. My other thing that I like to do to start these conversations is ask the med student, if we're rounding, to ask the patient in the hospital, what's your understanding of this hospitalization? And I would encourage anyone who attends with med students or with residents to ask patients that, because I'm always quite surprised that the patient's perspective and their goals are often not quite the same as the medical team. And it's important to know both to get the patient out safely and in a healthy manner. Asking patient goals, time admission or initial consultation, questions like, how do you make decisions? Who should be present for a conversation about your healthcare? And then I like this one too. It can be uncomfortable for people to talk about death and dying for a lot of reasons, so I'm not going to dive into, but trying to reframe the conversation as alleviating concerns regarding a particular illness can help sort of open individuals to talk about it more. So I'm going to return back to this take-home point from this talk. The bull looks different in the ring. Patients and surrogates will choose things that you would not choose for yourself or loved one. And as providers, we need to strive to approach these conversations, these discussions, these decisions without judgment. The duty of a provider, I think of myself as like when patients are like, when they have decisions that maybe go not, or that aren't in line with what my recommendations are, I always say, I'm like, you're the captain. I'm just the advisor and here for guidance, and it's up to you if you want to take my advice at all. So our duty when we're having these conversations is to provide the decision maker with the information necessary to make an informed decision, not to make the decision for them. This comes back to the idea of the bull looks different in the ring. We do have to take care to not judge someone's choices based on their lived experience and wishes. It doesn't mean that we don't respond emotionally or psychologically internally. I think it's important that all providers have a space to reflect on these experiences, but they should not impact the direct patient or caregiver or surrogate's relationship with the team. So we are not there to judge. We are there to guide. And we have to, a whole other part of medicine, find safe spaces for providers to explore these types of experiences, which are frequent. All right, in my final slides, I'm going to talk about some resources, but first I'm going to talk about everyone's favorite subject, reimbursement. And I'll just move quickly because I'm running out of time. So you can bill for this. It is covered by CMS. It is included in the annual wellness exam for no copayment. And if you bill outside of the annual wellness exam, it is subject to the cost sharing of Medicare Part B. So a lot of the things I was able to find was like 20% the patient will have to pay for. So they might get a bill of $20 if you bill for this. This is a really unique code because there's no limitations on it. So there's no limitation. There's nothing specific or it's not confined to a particular provider. So any provider can have these conversations and bill for them, and they can do it in any setting. It can be outpatient, it can be inpatient, and there's no specific diagnosis required. And these are the CPT codes up to 30 minutes and then 30 minutes after. And I would say this is more so a Band-Aid. So CMS, they want you to have these conversations. They're trying to incentivize us to understanding that physicians don't have the time to do this. So let's make it reimbursable and a bit more lucrative. This is the billing requirements, and it is actually quite lucrative. I know I'm primary care, so this is actually maybe more than what my one RVU is worth to me. So I know the special subline may be a bit more, but it is reimbursable at about $86 outpatient, $80 inpatient, and then $75 afterwards. And it's actually quite a hefty RVU allocations if you think about it as an additional code on top of the visit that you're doing. This is what needs to be included. In the interest of time, I'm going to move forward because I do want to show some resources that you can share. And I'll put the links in the chat. Okay, so let me pull up. So here are some resources that can assist with advanced care planning. If I can move my little, hold on, sorry, I can't see. There we go. I can do it this way because my little like box is in the front. Okay. So I'm going to go here first. What a lot of people are maybe more familiar with is this Five Wishes site. So it walks through a lot of the, on a very surface level, a lot of the topics that we've discussed today. Here's the bootleg version that's been, you can see, been copied so many times in the GIM clinic. You can barely read it anymore. So the thing to know about Five Wishes, which you'll hear about, which people really do enjoy working through as a family, is that you have to pay for it. It's not a lot, but it does still cost money. So it's $5 to get this, $15 to do it on your computer. So that's the one caveat to Five Wishes. There is this Prepare for Your Care that I found while preparing for this talk that is free. And it walks through patients through the whole process, preparing steps, discussing their wishes, and it has videos. So it's actually a great resource for patients. This is My Directives. We were using this at the system that I was previously working at. So My Directives is actually, it is an app, or it's a digital platform where you can store all of these documents. So it's stored in a cloud. So wherever you're hospitalized, there's access to them. You or a loved one can download it, or you can share it with providers. So this is free as well. So for those of you patients who have these documents, It would be great to, you know, share this with them if they want to upload it and save it. It's a free service, and it helps with that accessibility and portability portion. And then the final, back to my slides. Final thing I just wanted to introduce as a topic that you may or may not be familiar with. Some of you may have heard of what's called an ethical will. So this is another, I think, pretty special way to approach advanced care planning. So this is a document regarding one's spiritual health. So I don't know if it originates in other cultures. In my religious background, from a biblical standpoint, the ethical will or the legacy letter went from the patriarch to the son, that then spelled out the legacy of like the family to the next generation and what was included in that. That has evolved greatly since the biblical times. And now what an ethical will or a legacy letter includes is it communicates to future generations one's values, ethics, and purpose. So it has no legal significance to it, but it can be quite beautiful to leave for loved ones and survivors who are left behind. The most famous one that some of you may be available with, and this will be the second to last time I'm switching back and forth, is when he came into office, President Obama wrote a legacy letter to his daughters, and I'll put the link in for those of you who are interested, but it's a discussion of, you know, what he felt coming into the presidency that he wished to pave and saw and wanted to leave as his legacy for other children. And then another resource is this life legacy. So this is actually tools and resources, and they have workshops a few times a year where people can zoom in and actually work on their ethical wills. So definitely something interesting to look into if you're not familiar with the concept. And then in my final moments, I'm just gonna do just couple more book recommendations. Okay, so take home points. Let me do take home points first. Advanced care planning, hopefully you see it now as a longitudinal and dynamic process. Rather than getting trapped in the weeds of predicting what a detailed medical decision-making should look like, focus on revisiting the patient's values and goals at regular intervals to inform the in-the-moment decisions and near future decision-making. Here are a couple of books. Happier Endings and When For You When I Am Gone are having to do with ethical wills. The Beginner's Guide to the End is something that I am slowly working through. I used it as when I was pregnant with my second child. I started, you start thinking about, what sort of landscape you might, if something should happen to me, what my family, what landscape they would be left behind to. And it's more of like a practical way to move through preparing for, I'm not dying, but like, if something should happen unexpectedly. So like the first chapter is about like getting all those forms in order. So, they can find your retirement accounts and your life insurance policy and all of that. So that's more of a practical guide to the end. This is me trying to do my presentation from home. Those are my adorable children, Zev and Penny. And these are my references. So thank you everyone for your attention. I've timed it perfectly so nobody can ask me questions. I'm just kidding. I'm happy to stay up for questions. But thank you for your attention today. And I hope you found it helpful and interesting.
Dr. Shiroky, can you see the chat on your end?
I can now, so let me pull it up.
Okay, Dr. McCann's left a message for you.
Thank you. Yeah, there's a desperate need for more palliative care professionals and in the inpatient and in the outpatient setting, so thank you. Be careful, though, because any specialists on the line who provide me with their contact information know that I use it. but thank you. Right. Any other questions? Anything anyone wants to share? Okay. Well, thank you for your attention, everyone. I hope you enjoy the rest of the week and have a nice weekend. Thanks for this opportunity.
Thank you.